Cop movies and revenge films. You gotta love them. Seeing Liam Neeson going after the world for taking his daughter, or taking out mobsters by wearing their own faces after they burned him. This stuff is great. Or seeing Clint Eastwood take out the bad guy in his own way, only to later be chastised for political reasons by his boss. Legendary. And today, we combine both premises with Fritz Lang's ultimate noir, 1953's The Big Heat.
To all you out-of-work soda jerks without a penny to pinch, to the detectives with all the answers, to the dastardly dames who play men like baby dolls, and the trusted ones too pure for this world, and all you double-crossing, backstabbing, ruthless, baby-faced amateurs, this one's for you. So suit up, turn out the lights, put the match to your smokes, and sit back for the darker side of things. Cineshadow Moonlights, Noirvember.
We open with a close-up of a gun. A man shoots himself, and his wife finds him. She's not sentimental, though, and slips the suicide note in her pocket. He, Tom Duncan, head of the Records Bureau, and she, his wife Bertha. Bertha phones a Mr. Logano, a well-to-do man who has a personal assistant, or maybe a boyfriend. I'm generally adverse to gay subtext in older films, but when your butler is there in a bathrobe sitting on your bed at night handing you phone calls, well... Logano then phones a man, Vince, as it seems there was vital information in the note, and they are now being blackmailed. Then we are introduced to Sergeant Dave Banyan, played by Glenn Ford, as he investigates the suicide. Bertha gets into her act and starts crying. She claims her husband was deathly ill, supplying a motive for the suicide. Banyan heads home. Banyan and his wife Katie are very much in love, and, along with their daughter Joyce, are very much a happy family. They eat dinner together and joke around. It puts a big smile on my face. After a call from his boss, Banyan interviews a Lucy Chapman at the retreat. Apparently, Tom Duncan was a vain, happy man, lover of women, and not ill at all. That night, when Lucy is tortured, beaten, and thrown from a car dead, Banyan gets curious, and when told to lay off from his superior, decides to keep up the investigation. A bartender at the retreat, a Mr. Tierney, he don't know nothing, and calls his boss after Banyan leaves, but Banyan hasn't left, and he wonders who he called. He's gonna take him downtown, but Tierney knows Banyan is under pressure to stop the investigation, and he doesn't go. Something fishy is definitely going on here. Back at home, a man curses Banyan's wife out in a threatening phone call, and this pisses Banyan off. Banyan leaves to confront Logano at his home. There's a party going on. I guess Mr. Logano sort of runs things. That's no secret. Banyan implies Logano had Lucy Chapman killed. This insults him. You can't threaten an important man like Logano with his party and mansion and portrait of mother in his office. Banyan replies in kind. You couldn't plant enough flowers to cover up the smell. They attempt to throw him out, but he handles his own. Leaves on his own terms. Banyan is chastised again by his superior. Tensions are high, and they feel Banyan is too rough. Logano is after him now. Katie trusts her husband and stands by him. They are planning to go out that night. Banyan goes to tuck his daughter in for bed, and Katie to go out and start the car. As he tells his daughter a bedtime story, the starter rolls over and the car explodes, killing Banyan's wife and taking him over the edge. He knows who ordered it. He has a meeting with his lieutenant and the commissioner where he tells them both off and implies that the commissioner is in Logano's pocket. After quitting the force and handing over his badge, the commissioner asks for his gun. Banyan replies, "That doesn't belong to the department. It's mine. Bought and paid for. Revenge is the thing on his mind now." Banyan hides his daughter and beats information out of people. And that's where I'll leave you. I also wanted to mention that Lee Marvin is the one that plays Vince in one of his first film roles, and Gloria Graham plays his girlfriend Debbie. They are both great, and Marvin is a total jerk to her, at one point throwing a boiling pot of coffee right into her face, scarring her forever. What the hell? In conclusion, this film is great excitement. It's hard-boiled and unrelenting. And the ending is fantastic, as Banyan holds on to his humanity and has a touching moment when he tells a story about his wife to calm a dying woman. Whew. I'd say this is Glenn Ford's best performance, with his portrayal in Blackboard Jungle coming in at a close second. And Fritz Lang, in my heart, he can do no wrong.